In the attempt to get my cross-country skis on down at Sheldon Pond, and I was standing on a slab of ice.
Ski engine. Okay, so we can get started. So it looks like we have Paul Engels joining us remotely, and us in person. Did we hear anything about Ted today?
I think he mentioned at the last meeting that he would be absent tonight. I apologize that
Who did?
I think so, yes.
I thought he said,
oh, no, here he is.
I thought he told me he was coming, yeah.
There he is.
Not absent.
Waiting for me?
Yeah.
Not oh, no, we're waiting turning. For me. I was...
We'd written you off, Ted. But you're in the Caribbean having a drink on the beach.
I was taking too long.
Tomorrow.
Exciting.
Yeah.
Okay. So for all of us in attendance here, we actually have no audience members at the moment, but we all know we can go out the back of the room and either end of the hallway to get outside. Any changes to the agenda? Okay. We'll keep going. Open to public for items not related to the agenda. Is anyone joining us online who wanted to say something? Darylyn, did you? Okay. Anyone else? Okay. Announcements and staff report. Does anyone have any announcements?
I have a quick one. Okay. I attended the city council meeting last week, and I informed the mother of Joel, who was struck by a car the previous year, and I told her I was going to be attending, and so she also chose to join, and we both expressed our concerns about the lack of safety for the students, and I'm grateful. I believe that the city council will be taking that up in their next meeting on Monday. So, and secondly, I don't know if everyone read or listened to what Roseanne sent to everyone, which should probably be, I guess, listed in our meeting minutes since I'm talking about it and it went to all of us, but it was an excellent commentary on climate change and the impact on people moving as a result of it. So I really encourage everyone to listen to that if they haven't already. And I was going to reference some of it later when we get to our goals page. But if you haven't seen it, please, or listen to it, please do.
Yeah, that's about the havens. I haven't listened to it yet, but I will.
Great. I had a few things that I just added to the end of the agenda so we could all have them under other business. They're about emails and requests I had received. Any other announcements? Any other staff?
Just a quick note. I've alluded a couple times to having a subscription to a magazine called Zoning Practice. And this month's edition that just came out last week is on the subject of EV charging, electric vehicle charging, which I think is very timely to the adoption of the Climate Action Plan. And it talks both about the what various communities and states are doing in terms of ratios of if there's going to be a new parking lot, how many EV spaces to go with it, but also a conversation that we had actually just started at the staff level, which is what is EV charging as a use in and of itself? So we think today of a gas station and a convenience store. The version of this in the future might be associated with a coffee shop. Is it a coffee shop? Is it, what if they want to have 10 EV charging spaces? What if they want to have 100 EV charging spaces? Is it its own use that should be regulated like a gas station, or is it going to be ancillary to something like at Healthy Living where the it's just, you know, spots for Tesla? And it's a really interesting sort of, what do we think that this might be in the future and how do we want to think about it? Like, you know, right now we limit the number of new gas stations that could take place in the city. If essentially, what if somebody wanted to come forward and say, I'd like to create a, essentially just a parking lot with 50 EV charging spaces along Shelburne Road? Is that a, where does that fit in our land use goals? So not an immediate thing, but I something I'll share with you to have you thinking on about what the future means for this stuff.
You reminded me of one other thing I wanted to mention, which I'll share this article, but there was just an article out about some based on NASA's knowledge, there are 5-minute charging opportunities, perhaps in the near future. So that could really change things as well. And I guess just a reminder that on October 1, cannabis became legal to sell, and it's in Burlington, Winooski, and Essex. All right. So anyway, just that for the record, we'd all acknowledge that cannabis is now legally sold for over the counter.
Correct. And in South Burlington, it can be grown, mm-hmm. and that counts as light industry. So wherever we have light industry, the it has not been put in front of the voters to consider the retail sale of it. So that's not today permitted in South Burlington. If the council decides at some point that they'd like to put it on the ballot, we would certainly be coming to you at the same time frame to talk about zoning and where it might be appropriate to have or not have. But as of today, it's not allowed as a retail use because it has to be opted in by the voters under the law.
So that wouldn't just immediately come to us. There'd be, you know, everything leading up to a vote before it would become a land use.
Correct. Right. Although I imagine that if the council were to decide to put it on the ballot, it may be of interest in the community to think of where it would be. So it might be something that would happen in parallel if it were decided. But right now, there's not any consideration of it going on the ballot.
Okay. Great. Anything else? Okay, we can move on to item number 5, which is minor differences between the C1 R15 and C1 auto zoning districts. We have a public hearing coming up on this, and staff had identified some minor differences and just wanted to make sure that we were all on the same page with these uses.
Yeah, so I know that the commission wanted to make sure that things went as precipitously as possible. I had previously said that there were essentially no differences between the C1 R15, commercial 1 residential 15, and the C1 auto district, except for auto sales. In preparing the planning commission report, I saw that there are some differences, and I thought that A, it's transparent to share them, and B, wanted to give the commission the opportunity to have a discussion and have a game plan going into the public hearing. You are allowed to make any additional changes following the public hearing without having to rewarn the hearing. If it would be acceptable, I'll just share what my staff markup of that might be.
Oh, sorry, just that last point. So the council can vote on this, and then we're permitted to adjust these uses without a public hearing?
So you, as the planning commission, before you send it to the council, can make changes to the document that you were that you held the hearing on.
Okay.
Once you give it to council, the public process reason being there's still an opportunity for the public at the council hearing. If they make changes after public hearing, they must warn another one. But you can make changes on related topics.
But only after the public hearing. We can't make changes on what we've warned.
You can give guidance to staff as to what you would like to, what you expect to do. But the actual changes, you're right, would be after the public hearing because the warning has been on what was put in the paper.
Yeah. So I think the idea is
there would have to be another hearing.
I'm just saying you can't vote to do it tonight, but immediately following your public hearing, you could say we'd like to make the following additional changes. Because the public
that would not require another hearing.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think if we made a major change, then it would be different enough.
If it was unrelated.
You know, but if it's still related, and I think we could present that we had this conversation, maybe we wanted to make a change, we could do that as part of the public hearing too. So we had that discussion like before the public hearing was closed, if we wanted to. So.
So my suggestion, and Michael, I'd love to hear your thoughts in a moment because I know you shared something around. My simple suggestion for you all, I had indicated previously that the C1 Auto is very, very similar to the C1 R15. My recommendation would be to essentially make them more similar than they were. So this is a typo. We don't have any uses that say PUD anymore, but basically allow these additional things in the C1 Auto: congregate care, cultural facility, educational facility, things that are attractive things to be along Shelburne Road regardless. The only ones I would leave out, because I think that they are proving to be challenging to be near people, are animal shelter and kennels. That I think that those are proving to be difficult.
What was the kennel, did you say?
Yeah.
Yes.
Are okay. Proving to be difficult to where near where people live. Exactly. And I would not, I think that deserves some attention by itself, but not adding areas where they're allowed right now. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then I think that would be a fairly simple tidy up. Mm-hmm. But so that's my thought on it. Michael, I know you shared something around, maybe you wanted to.
Yeah, I think, but that is for, I think that's a next step, because it seems that when I look at all these automotive uses or businesses along Shelburne Road from Swift all the way down to Allen, there's not a lot of opportunity. There are places where we can zone C1 R15, but not a lot, where, because there's automotive and stuff everywhere, so it would be hard to fit it in. So my suggestion for the future was to simplify it and combine C1 Auto with C2, since they're very similar. And we've got C2, that's the purple, mm-hmm. goes all the way down from a certain point, but then doesn't cover what we've now made into C1 Auto. It seems, it just doesn't seem necessary to have two zones that are so similar.
Is the C2 lower density?
Yeah, I was going to say, we lose density there, though, don't we?
It is lower density, and it has some other uses. I think mm-hmm. I agree, Michael, with your a good next step. There are some other uses like self storage that are allowed in C2 and heavier industry. I think the objective is a good one, but I didn't want good to be the enemy of the great in this timeline of what you're working on here.
Yeah.
And this is not part of your work plan this year, so I didn't.
Earlier made a note that C2 permitted uses could be added, which are now conditional, like congregate care, mm-hmm. assisted living, cultural facility, educational, skilled nursing, social services, commercial or public parking, hotel extended stay, service station, and then your comment the other day about adding municipal facility as a permitted use. But if there's a density, we may be giving up some density, but I want to protect as much of the C1 R15 as possible.
Andrea?
So, well, I noticed that some of the uses that are now conditional, I guess you're recommending to make permitted. So that was a conscious decision, or?
No, I guess I put the letter P there as in, I meant to say they should be, thank you for that, treated the same.
Okay.
So where it says conditional, make it conditional.
Okay.
Where it says permitted, make it permitted. Although I think it's a separate conversation that you might want to just say that assisted living is permitted at some future time. But my intent was
good form
to match the two. I just typed it too quickly. I used control V instead of the C. So the congregate care, skilled nursing, and social services would be C's, not P's.
Yeah, great question. I think it makes sense to have it be the same. Any other questions or comments on this?
Like what Paul did, that was my only comment about the animal related businesses for exactly what we experienced over on Street.
And Paul Engels, please speak up or wave, you know, if you want to add anything. Also, I want to make sure I'm not missing your input.
Okay. Can you see me now?
No, we see your name, but not your face.
Okay. I can see you and we're okay in terms of hearing each other. So I'll just speak up if I have something. Okay.
Perfect.
Thanks. We remember what you look like, Paul.
Yep.
Unless you shaved your beard, in which case we don't.
Yeah. Not yet.
Okay. Okay. Well, I guess my sense is that with the changes Paul was just making up there, this seems like something we'd be interested in pursuing.
Okay. So I'll put it in your packet as a proposed change formally at your next meeting that you would do following the public hearing, and then you can loop them all together and send it to council. Good.
Very good. Okay, so we can move on to number six, which is to provide feedback to the City Charter Committee on consideration of enabling the expansion of the Planning Commission membership. And Paul Engels is on the Charter Committee. So I don't know if either Paul Engels or Paul Connor wants to say a few words about this before we jump in.
I can say a couple things and then Paul can pick up on whatever I'm missing. Right now, our city charter says that the Planning Commission will be 7 members. It specifies 7. By state law, it can be anywhere from 3 to 9 members. So we could not expand the council to 10 or 11, I mean, the commission to 10 or 11 members. But if we wanted to, we could expand it to 9. To do that, we first have to go to the voters and ask them to remove the word 7, which is in our charter now. And then I believe separately, Paul, if you, you know, if you feel the need to correct me, go ahead. But then a separate effort would have to be made to establish how many people we did want between 3 and 9. So, and that would be, I think, subsequent to removing the word 7. So that is basically, I think, what we have. Paul, do you have any thoughts?
Just one small edit to what you said. So a city charter is state law because it's adopted by the legislature. So there's really 2 options for the city. One, as Paul described, is that if the voters approved and then the legislature approved deleting the 7 members, then we would default to the standard state law, which is 3 to 9. And under a recently changed state law, the number that is actually sitting, in our case 7, would then be able to be modified by the voters in a separate vote, as Paul just described. Alternatively, the second option could be that if the city chose to change its charter and put a new number in, let's say 9, that would also then become state law because a city charter is state law. So it would be an option of the city to just specify a different number rather than putting it to a 2-step thing. Mm-hmm. And of course, a third option is to not change anything.
If it goes to the voters, are they given to say, we were at 7, we want to go to 9, or do they pick a number?
No, it would be, they would be given a yes, no vote. So the proposal is to change it to 9, let's say, or to delete the language. Do you approve of this change or not?
I have a comment. I looked at the meeting minutes pertaining to this from the Charter Committee, because I was having a conversation with somebody actually about something school related, doing a ton of research. And I found out that there's a number of incidences. This is out of our purview, by the way, but there are a number of incidences in our charter where for some reason South Burlington decided that we're different from and better than whatever the state decides. And so another similar example to this is that the state has a statute. This is where I figured this out. The state has a statute that says that school districts can set appropriate speed zones in their, in front of their schools. Except in South Burlington, you can't because our charter and as perhaps a city ordinance that then was in our charter said, oh, but not here. And so I actually had a conversation with somebody who is on the charter committee separately. Just, you know, my general comment is, I mean, we don't, our charter committee meets like every 10 years. I don't know. It's not a regular thing. People at the state level are meeting and discussing a whole manner of issues and updating ordinances on a regular basis. I don't know why there's any circumstance in which South Burlington would, within our charter, not our LDRs, but within our charter, do something that says that we need to be different from the rest of the state. So I'm just putting it out there. And the second thing, I did look in the meeting minutes, and I was, somebody said, gee, they'd like to know something a little more official from the Planning Commission about our thoughts on this. But we do have, we did have a conversation about this and had a casual, like, you know, sure, there's subcommittee opportunities. And I think there, I don't think there was a motion, but we did have a previous discussion about it. So not that we decide the same thing now, but I was surprised that that didn't seem official enough.
I don't think there was an agenda item to it. It might have been somebody raised it under other business, and so we wanted to have this be, okay, if there was going to be a, either a discussion or a recommendation that was warned to the public, that's why we wanted to.
So my feedback to the Charter Committee is just in general, I mean, it seems like a larger review of why would the city ever want to and maybe there's very good reason, you know, but like in so many other towns, the school board can decide, yes, we want to go to 20 or 25 miles in front of our school, except if you're in South Burlington, you can't, then the city has to get involved. So
so just to like bring this back to the issue specifically, would your recommendation be that the charter not specify a number?
You know, so I mean, it would personally, I think it should just reflect what the state, it's twofold. I think it should reflect whatever the state is saying, because the state is looking at this on a regular basis. Is it a big enough deal to, I think that would require a larger review of the charter. Is it necessary to pull this one topic out? I guess that would be up to the charter committee and the city council. I think this is something they should look at throughout the charter.
Right. I do want to be clear that the council has tasked the charter committee with looking at certain things. This is one of the things that they've tasked the charter committee to look at specifically. So I think the charter committee is hoping to get your specific feedback on the planning commission element. Broader guidance, if you'd like, is absolutely welcome. And that should be directed to council, because council sets what the charter committee is to be looking at.
And the charter committee has asked me to find out from the planning commission what we all think of this proposal. So we meet tomorrow afternoon at 4 o'clock. And so whatever we decide tonight is what I'll be reporting tomorrow.
Great.
I'm sorry, with Monica's comments, what is the exact proposal that we're being asked to give feedback on? So I thought it was to go from 7 to 9, but is it something else?
Well, there are other things being considered, right, but the specific ask of the planning commission is on this.
Should we change 7 to 9?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, originally I was leaning towards increasing the body, you know, to 9, thinking as though we could break down into subcommittees and so on. And it seemed to make sense, but the more I think about it, I'm leaning much more towards the existing 7. And you see, when I was on the city council in Burlington, we had 13. And it was a little unwieldy being the chair. of course, maybe it was the dynamics of progressive Republicans and Democrats. That might have been it. But it can get a little unwieldy as a body. You know, it's great to have these subcommittees, but to have 13 members, or in this case, 9. It just adds some dynamics that I don't think there's a benefit there. I mean, this question about, do we have diversity and we're all white and, you know, all kinds of things there, but that can change with let's say the council, that's their responsibility. It doesn't mean that we have to go to 9 or 8, whatever. So that's just my feelings. I haven't heard of a compelling reason, and maybe someone can make that tonight.
Yeah, I'm also not in favor of expanding it to 9, but that's partly from my personal experience, you know, running executive committees and being on a form-based code committee, which had at least 16 members, and it was super unwieldy, and other committees. And I've always found that at least committees that I've been chairing, that 5 is actually the best number to get things done in a timely manner. But 7 is okay. But more than 7, I think it becomes unwieldy. I mean, you know, it took us 3 years, I think, to complete the whole LDR rewrite. And I was trying to imagine how long it would have taken if we had 9 conversations instead of 7 for every agenda item and subject. I mean, we often can barely get through our full agenda, not to mention ending on time, just with 7 of us, plus sometimes 1 or 2 staff. So, you know, and as I also thought about this subcommittee issue, and we've rarely had to appoint them in the time that I've been here, maybe 3. Staff takes care of the collection of most of the background information that we need, and the investigations and recommendations come to us from them, which is as it should be. So I'm in favor of leaving it as it is. It's workable. And I think going to 9 would make our work that much more onerous and time consuming.
Duncan?
Yeah, I've kind of gone both ways on it. I mean, I think the thought that to get some perspective that I don't think we have right now on the commission would be for me a reason to possibly look at expanding. You know, and again, the city council makes a decision on who they appoint to the planning commission. I think that was the perspective that for me thought, yeah, it could be a good idea. But I hear what you're saying, Ted. I mean, more doesn't always necessarily mean better. I guess it comes down to, you know, and you brought this up, Monica, that, you know, we geographically, we're not very diverse. You know, and I think there's some perspectives that we are missing. You know, again, the city council, you know, they could appoint 2 people that don't have that expertise, and we have 2 more people on the council, on the commission. So, Paul, you said you had looked at a number of towns with 9. Are there any experiences or pluses or minuses that you were able to glean from that?
So most of the communities, there are not very many that responded saying that they have 9 in Vermont. Most of them were very, very, very small ones. And they described the benefit in that case that there's more bodies to do the legwork. The 2 communities that were a little bit bigger were Richmond and Hinesburg. And they said that it has worked fine. Both reported that they have often not had a full 9 appointed by their select board because they just can't find 9 people. But they said it's been fine. Neither expressed that there's some, you know, I was sort of hoping that I might hear something that's working really well with it or not working really well, but I suppose it's like anything when you're in the middle of it, it just is what it is. I think I heard a little bit of, you know, having more people gives you a greater chance, if not everybody is attending, to still have a robust discussion. On the flip side of that, having a greater number means a greater quorum number, which can therefore mean that if you don't get all the people, it gets harder to have a vote. I don't think that for the most part, when you've been a full body of 7, that you've had an attendance
challenge. Occasionally when you're down a person or two, you have, but for the most part, when you've been a full body of seven, that's not been a major problem. Yeah. So I didn't learn that much from the other communities, but that's what I did here.
So there is a little background to this specific issue coming to us, which I think everybody knows, when I reapplied or considered reapplying for my term, which just started, I actually asked the city council not to apply or select me again, because I'm concerned about the lack of diverse perspectives. My intention was to not submit my application. And then somebody on the council said, well, wait, that's not really a concern because we can add two people because there's this new state thing. And so my response the next day was, if that's what the council will want to do, I understand there's a process, but if that's the intention, then I'm happy to serve my piece, because that I hope that you will be more concerned about the diversity of perspective in naming the two new people. And that if for whatever reason the city council decided not to, I was kind of really looking at 3 years of commitment, I was inclined to say, please give my seat to somebody who can bring that diversity. And that's why this question came to us in an unexpected way. I didn't expect it to go this way. I thought the state law said you can do this, so I didn't think it was going to be an issue. So with that perspective, I do feel, I don't want my having brought this up in the first place to be the reason anyone gives an opinion one way or another. But I did just want to remind of that. I think I probably still feel the same if we were to stay at seven, and please don't, I hate to even bring that up here. I also don't otherwise, other than that, I can't say that I would support seven versus nine. You know, I don't have a personal preference for nine. I was disappointed that we couldn't get the neighborhood outreach program going that Paul and I wanted to get going, because it really would have taken every single one of us to do it, and not everyone was able to commit. If we had nine, might we have been able to pull something like that together? Maybe, but you know, that's every 8 years. So I am not, I'm basically indifferent, and I'll figure out my own, status afterwards, but please, I'm indifferent on the seven versus nine.
Do you want to weigh in, or?
I think seven makes sense for the reasons articulated.
Okay. So it sounds like in general, seven seems like a good number. We've had, if we add more to every single discussion, there'd be maybe time. Right now, I think we've had a really high level of investment from everyone. You know, with seven, I think hopefully everyone feels like they're being heard and their perspectives are being heard. We've also had a really high level of attendance. It sounds like at least some of the other communities were maybe not having as good of attendance. I don't know if that's because they felt like a smaller fish in a bigger pool, maybe not as, I don't know why, but it does sound like we're interested in making sure that the seven of us have a variety of backgrounds with, I heard mentioned geography, professional experience or expertise, and diversity. So those are things that aren't really in the charter and really have more to do with the city council's choices. So, I mean, maybe there's a way, before the last round of interviews, I did have a conversation with the council chair kind of to say some of the things that some of the shoes Bernie had filled, with professional expertise and things. So maybe we could suggest to the council that there's a little more maybe targeted like choosing kind of based on some of those things to make sure we're getting a diversity of locations of the city. We've had conversations in the past about types of housing too. So maybe there's some things that we could work with the council to like really think through attributes. But it sounds like it's not related to 7 versus 9 necessarily. It's more about a diversity of what's coming to the table.
Right. When you say, obviously, yes, we miss Bernie, but is it, it's his engineering training or skills? And I think we have that. Funnily enough, Andrew has a couple of engineering degrees. And I just wanted to say, though, that with 7, I think we have a very, very strong esprit de corps here. I think everybody has great respect. We have great respect for each other. And it's one of the reasons that we can work so well together. And I find that esprit de corps crucial and important for my satisfaction with the work we do here.
Okay. Paul, do you feel like you got some good feedback to be able to share, or would you like anything more specific or concrete?
No, I don't think so. I mean, we could take a vote if we want to, but I don't really think it's necessary. I just, I'll talk to the charter committee tomorrow and give them a sense of what everybody's response has been to this today. So I should say that I was initially a little shocked and surprised to see it on the charter committee agenda. When the shock wore off, I guess my thought was, if it's not broke, don't fix it. But the 7 is really pretty good, So, and it sounds like pretty much everybody is saying that tonight too. So I don't know, Jessica, how you want to do this, if you want to vote or if you want to just tell me to tell the charter committee that.
Do we need a motion so that they have certainty on the charter committee?
Can do that, sure.
I mean, would that make your job easier, Paul?
Yes.
Okay. Would someone like to make a motion, make an attempt?
Okay. I move that the proposal to increase the members of the commission from 7 to 9 be discarded and not discarded. I guess that's not a good motion.
I think just that it's
restated.
Have the planning commission not recommend.
Just not that our recommendation might be.
No, I think I should rather go back and start over again with that motion. That I move that the membership of the planning commission remain at 7 members.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Okay, all in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Aye.
Me too.
Any nay? Nay? Any abstain?
I'm abstaining.
Okay, so the motion passes.
Sue, I know that just so that you're making sure, that was 6-1, correct?
I abstain.
5-1-1.
Okay.
And then do we want an official motion to provide some of that additional feedback directly to council, or should I just kind of informally speak with the council chair about some of the other things that we talked about tonight, about the makeup of the, in the future, if there's openings?
Yeah.
I think diversity of opinion is really important. I've learned so much being here over 6 years by listening to and learning from people that came from different perspectives. For me, it's really helped me. So I would strongly encourage some way of ensuring that diversity is found in new candidates. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I will have a conversation with the council chair to pass on these other comments. Okay. So moving on to the next item is the debrief on the Joint Planning Commission Council meeting and discuss the revised values, vision, goals of the comprehensive plan. So we had an updated version in our packet for discussion.
Can I give two sentences of table setting?
Yes, please.
Sentence number one, I tried to incorporate as all the themes that I heard from this past week, from the joint meeting and from the various markups that folks gave, and feel free to adjust as however you'd like. And then sentence two is, if the commission, my recommendation would be if the commission feels that you're at 90% in it, to accept it as a working document, having the guidance to then share with the committees, with the public about sort of broadly where you're going is to me more important than, let's say, having 2 months go by of working on the little details, as you may as well learn through the public input some additional things. But if you feel that it's not at 90% and it's at 50%, then please make some adjustments to it. Or if there's something that you feel is really critical, but that's my guidance.
I feel it's pretty good as drafted. There's only one thing that I think we should consider adding to the inclusive bullet, and that is somehow to recognize the historical presence and culture and customs of the indigenous population. It's come up so often for discussion, maybe not in the commission, but elsewhere in South Burlington. I think maybe Monica had raised it once or twice. So I think it's an omission that we should try and fill by adding some language to the inclusive, fair, and just section.
Do you want feedback on that as we go? Is there general support for adding something to that effect, to that first section? Or I'm seeing some nods.
I guess what does that do?
It's an acknowledgement of the history of South Burlington. And it's a population that is largely ignored, and that's not something that I'm comfortable with.
I probably should know, having been here for so long, but what is the history behind? I mean, have there been settlements here?
Yes.
Okay.
This was the Abenaki.
Yeah. I know the Abenaki. Yeah. I just wasn't per se.
This was where they lived.
okay.
We had, so when we had done the joint meeting with the city council, I think was it last July, there was some really great discussion from two of the chiefs kind of about
access.
This topic and access for foraging and it was really quite interesting. And I don't have like exact details of like what would be said specifically, but it was a great conversation where it did come up. And I don't think our community has a lot of current access and partnerships, but it sounded like you know, the people who were there were interested in forming more partnerships on the lands.
You know, I had access in mind because that was, as you say, discussed. And but that's why I didn't. I just used the language of that I made up, and to acknowledge the historical presence and the cultural and culture and customs of the indigenous population. And that kind of implies, if we recognize and acknowledge their customs and cultural culture, that access for foraging, which is part of their culture, is implicit. You might want to make it more explicit in this document.
Anything else?
I guess two things. I would just say, I don't know how that fits in to this page and that section. I think the concept is excellent. I think it's, I don't know how to frame it in a way that's appropriate here, because there's so many issues around it, that to give it a one-liner to me almost makes me feel like, is that more of a do-good versus a true good? And so I don't know if there's a broad way, because then there's also probably, if we go back in our history, we'll probably find that there were farmers of color in our areas that were basically Vermont made very difficult for their living, and we've lost a lot of farmers of color and across this entire state. So I feel that there's, if we're looking at trying to honor our history, I'm just not clear on where that goes here, but I love the idea. So I would guess that's what I would say to that. And then my second comment was going to go back to what Roseanne sent to us, which I do wish you guys would all look at. And I don't know if this fits into climate resilient, because I think that's where it should go, but it might go under human focused. But basically, the On Point talked a lot about this is an 8-year plan and we're still years out of it. So over the next 10 years, there will be people that are suffering in this country from a climate crisis, and they're going to be looking for safe harbor. And there were things within that conversation that other communities are doing, that saying things like, what something in here says, conserve important historical sites and structures. I mean, they're saying, let's take a real look at what is important here that we want to continue to protect, but at the same time, what can we start to do differently, knowing what's coming, so that we can be ahead of it as best we can, from infrastructure and who knows what else. So there are different communities that are doing things, and we have an opportunity to put that in. I would put that into this is good at the 90% level. And I would say, can we all listen to this and really understand some of this language? Because there are examples that I think we can basically cut and paste that other communities are talking about to be prepared for what will be happening in the coming years. It talks about a family from, they're in Buffalo, New York, though. But basically, Buffalo is going to be a hotbed for this, and Vermont is specifically called out as well. So I think it's very appropriate to have, and to me it falls under climate resiliency, that it will happen. So
that's, did you say Buffalo is a hotbed?
Yeah. Yes. Buffalo is there's the Buffalo. Well, and one of the reasons is because Buffalo has been extremely welcoming. They've been extremely welcoming to climate
refugees.
Yeah. Great. So they have a really good system in place. So.
I agree with Monica that maybe putting it on this first page is, I think the word you might have been looking for is tokenism. But I also think that in the body of the plan, in the demographic section, we can go into a lot more detail on this subject of Indigenous people, as well as this question of how to accommodate climate refugees. I alluded to it at the joint meeting in a in an oblique way when I was talking about carrying capacity. And I believe we can't accept an influx of climate refugees now because we don't have anywhere to put them. And that's why I said we will need some courageous and very controversial zoning in order to accommodate an influx of climate refugees in housing that they can afford. Has to be multiple, has to be high rise, you know, that kind of thing.
So my question to you, okay,
I was going to say that I also had made a point that South Burlington should declare itself a refugee receiving city. And I look at Burlington's Old North End, which was where a lot of refugees were settled, and it's fantastic. You talk about diversity. It's absolutely wonderful to be up there. Sadly, we don't have that stock of old buildings that was available in the Old North End to accommodate these people, but we could make it if we set our minds to it.
Other comments or thoughts?
I think you did a great job.
It was interesting. I went back and looked at the 2016 goals because my thought was we only mentioned the economy once. It's mentioned in one bullet point. And I went back and looked at 2016 and it was the same then. But I think for a lot of people that might raise an eyebrow. It's a pretty important part of our city. And I'm not sure how else we can call that out. I was just looking at that sentence, and I'd love to see the word robust in there. And also, we call out local agricultural and food products. What about other local products? What about services? The local economy as a whole. I'm not sure how we could better call that out, support for that.
Duncan, maybe we could add something, or you could add something under the opportunity oriented, because that's where.
Yeah, no, I think that's where it belongs. Yeah. But I just thought it was interesting. We only mentioned the economy once, and
we support a diverse and resilient economy with quality jobs. That's in there.
I'm not sure how else we could call that out. I mean, I texted Julie Beatty, who's our staff liaison for the SBBA, and I asked her, how many businesses do we have in South Burlington? And I think the last count we had was 1,600, of which probably a large chunk are sole proprietors or small LLCs. And if I'm one of those people looking at this list, I'm thinking, okay, there's a lot of good stuff on here, but, what about my job?
Something like encouraging entrepreneurship.
That's a word we don't have in here.
I'm thinking
of and again, I thought I was reading this last night and I couldn't think, okay, what could I say? What could I say? And I thought, I'll think about it tomorrow at work. And I got to work and I had to work. But if anybody has any ideas, I just feel like we should call it out a little bit better or a little bit more.
Do you think there's a reason or a way that something like that should be under either human focused or climate resilient? Like that idea that we have jobs and services that are here and local, and we don't need to be driving somewhere far away to get groceries or things or, your hair done, or, that idea that you have all of those things that you're looking for here in our community, and we're supporting them.
Design, mixed use. I think that's what, at least that's as a,
yeah,
I think that's what that was trying to say. Maybe that can be fleshed out more.
I think that there might, I'm hearing sort of two themes. One is the access to services in a local manner that is both helping them as small businesses and serving transportation and climate goals. And then I think there's another piece that I'm hearing that is slightly different, which is investing in an economy that supports Vermont, meaning businesses and manufacturers who base their essentially headquarter here and return to our local economy to have a thriving local industry, which might be something like OnLogic or something like that, versus necessarily something where, you know, they're positioned here, but, you know, everything is leaving. Certainly, I think that's been a strategy of ours to the extent that we have an economic development strategy to try to support businesses that return to the local economy as much as possible. Maybe there's something along both of those lines that could be said. Maybe that entrepreneurship speaks to that of what Ted speaks.
So Andrew had been trying to go before.
Thank you. I think this is definitely at 90%. I mean, but I agree with both those comments as well. And I agree with Michael's comment too, but I think you did a great job. The one thing that, and I hadn't mentioned this at the last meeting, the community is concerned about taxes, right? Size of government. Should there be something in here like fiscal discipline or something of that nature? That is a goal and something that we should strive for.
You mean we're not paying enough taxes? Or
No. It's just to be conscious, right?
No.
Of fiscal decisions.
Strive for fiscal
discipline or something like that.
But that gets into governance, and I'm not sure where
we don't get involved with
taxes. Where would we?
You don't think that's part of the that?
I don't disagree with you, but I'm not sure where
you don't know where it would fit.
Yeah, I mean, that's
too subtle. I would say that in my head, Andrew, and this is might literally be only in my head, it was under the be equity oriented in governance, policy development, and implementation, meaning that as we think about policies, there's the impacts of a policy and then there's the cost of a policy. And if we're going to be equitable in the cost of our policy, we need to think about not every taxpayer has the same fiscal capacity, but that may either be too subtle or not what you're getting at.
That's part of it. I think that being fair in terms of the impact across residents is obviously critically important, but having fiscal discipline also generally for the city as a whole, I think is also important and not really articulated here.
I mean, could you add it in that sentence, be equity oriented, transparent, and fiscally
responsible
in governance?
Yeah, adding the words fiscally responsible makes sense to me in that bullet.
Paul Ingalls, did you have something?
Yes. I think that we should acknowledge that we're an economic engine for Vermont, that much of the business and industry in Vermont right now and the growth in Vermont is taking place in South Burlington. I think we should applaud ourselves for that and be determined to continue in that direction.
Anything else? So it's
my, I was going to actually respond to what Duncan was talking about before when.
Go ahead.
So I see that dignified was added into the inclusive and fair. And when I brought up the whole concept of dignity, which for me is a kind of a check and balance on everything that I look at, in these issues. Part of it too is that South Burlington is a place where you can have a dignified professional experience. You can hope, we would hope that there is a plethora of types of jobs here, different levels. We need people that are, you know, willing to take the jobs to keep a Chipotle open, and we need people that to work here that are going to run businesses that are going to make everything, you know, battery operated airplanes. We recognize that we need all of these people, and we need the businesses that will provide, and we want everyone who takes whatever the job is to understand how much it's appreciated. And that to me is what a dignified professional experience is, that we're all in this together. And I think it can tie into the importance of having a strong economic base here. So that it's, again, that tied in, the dignity is kind of a bigger, you know, check and balance for all of that, if that's helpful.
Okay, well, it looks like Paul has some possible edits up. I think ideally we'd have something that we're comfortable sharing. Or what do you think? Do you think?
I mean, if you're comfortable with my sort of including some of these words that you've shared, I don't know that you need to sort of have another meeting where you take another action on it. I heard maybe not including the recognition of Indigenous persons here, but to put that subject into the body of the work.
If you heard it from me, I think it still needs to go in here because it's such a big omission in general, but only a one liner, and then expand on it in the body of the plan. So I would still like to see it in here, see something about Indigenous that we know they're there and have been here, not that they don't appear anywhere. And I think it should be shown up front, and then get into it in more detail elsewhere. Okay. In the document.
Do we have maybe just a straw poll about adding it here? So if you're okay with, or if you're in support of adding it here, raise your hand. Add it here.
Okay.
And the fiscally responsible one, I'm thrown by, and I just want to, I wonder if, because we're going to send this out as a 90% page, I want to make sure we all understand what that means. I'm a little bit confused by it, because what is the Planning Commission's purview pertaining to that statement?
Well, remember, this is the city's plan, right? It doesn't ultimately, you're the ones tasked with preparing it, but ultimately this is the city's plan.
Okay.
Or it is the council's policy on across the board. So I know that means there's some areas that you're more expert in and less expert in.
So how does it relate to being equity oriented? Why isn't it under point number one, or like, why is it there? Why is it attached to being equity oriented?
So we're talking about governance. That's why I threw it in there.
Yeah, it's about policy, governance, investment. So for all those spheres of city government, city influence, city policy, be equity oriented, transparent, and fiscally responsible. Seems to be, at least it reads well to me.
Okay, then.
Okay, then moving down.
Ted mentioned entrepreneurial.
Yes,
that he should go in. Where did you want that to go, Ted?
No, I think that's okay. That would be where it would.
And Paul mentioned the idea of making more specific reference to the role, both present and future, of South Burlington as an economic engine of the state. I think that there's a way to wrap those two together, mm-hmm. If that would be okay with all of you.
Yep.
Was there a bullet point below that or still or?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. It was my thought that those that would dovetail with what Duncan had said.
Mm-hmm. Paul, I'm also wondering, I know you put something about services up above. I think you, I saw a bullet. Should I just scroll up a little bit? Right, nearby services. I'm wondering if you could, if that's better in the opportunity oriented. We say provide services. We can say provide services, particularly local services or something. I mean, you can just kind of fit it in. In the first bullet in opportunity oriented.
Oh, sorry. So say that again. Oh, put the comment about nearby services.
Yeah. You can just say, encourage or provide services, with a focus on local services, just something like that. Yeah.
Well, people, I certainly make choices to buy from local businesses mm-hmm. rather than chains that are national. And that, I think, plays into that and would encourage that.
I'm thinking that in that opportunity-oriented category, the third bullet point, where it says support a diverse, resilient economy, and then the last words are end food products, we could include and say and entrepreneurship there right after that. In other words, you did a litany of different categories and then entrepreneurship would be next. Just a thought of where that could go.
Rather than where it is.
Yeah. But I don't know. Just thinking, a full, I didn't see the full breakout. That's fine too.
Okay.
Why don't we let Paul massage this and send it out to us before the next meeting so we can.
So what I'll do is I'll send it out to you this week. And if any commissioner would like to further discuss it at your next meeting, let me know. Mm-hmm. But I will assume otherwise that you're good with it. Is that a fair?
Yep.
Okay. Because I'd love to start to get this out into the community and start to use this as guidance for committees, et cetera, et cetera. So good.
I hate to go backwards, but what is the definition of human squint? It says we're human focused, invest in a city oriented to a high quality human scale built. What does human scale mean?
It might be a little bit of planner ease that I can try to work on. What it means is a environment in which somebody talked about the 15-minute city before. The idea that you can walk to your services is one component of it. And the other part of it is that I would describe Shelburne Road as being the opposite of human scale. If you're walking along the sidewalk,
okay,
you feel as though it is not an environment designed for you.
Okay.
Perfect. If you walk along, I don't want to pick Church Street because that's a little bit too obvious, but if you were to walk along, say, even Pine Street in Burlington, you'd say, I feel sort of equivalently, the environment is equivalently for me and a car. I don't feel out of place in this environment. It's an enjoyable experience. The sort of physical shape of things is mm-hmm. In scale with a human. So there's a whole sort of urban design theory about how wide streets are supposed to be compared with how tall the buildings are and what the landscaping is. And that it all sort of comes into that.
So it's quality of life. That's the short. Yes.
That's an easier way to say it.
Yeah.
There's a movie you should see then, Ted, and it's called The Human Scale, made by I think a town planner or an architect or a group, but it's absolutely it'll change your mind about things.
Was that what we saw at the beer? There was something down
at the waterfront.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. One other question I had is not to nitpick, but it says back in the opportunity oriented far down, support a diverse and resilient economy with quality jobs. Again, what are we defining a quality job as? PNP Septic, is that a quality job or is it finance? Is it hourly? I mean, I don't know what a quality job is. It's pretty subjective.
I think Monica was getting at that with the dignity, just that a quality job could be any type of job if they're treated well and appreciated and
compensated.
That compensated, and that it shouldn't be only computer sector jobs, or it shouldn't be only a certain group of jobs, but quality jobs across many different.
Well, I guess let me put a slight counter to that in terms of how I've looked at this historically. I agree with that. And also, as you consider a choice in your zoning of do we allow for large format retail or do we allow for manufacturing to be in a given place? If you know we only have a certain amount of land, which of those two pieces do you want to allow? The regulations have skewed in some parts of the city to say, let's make sure we're reserving places for manufacturing type jobs rather than any job that somebody wants to bring in. So I guess that's how I've looked at that a little bit. But you know, this is your policy document. So
Michael?
I think quality job is the quality is in the mind of the person who holds that job or does that job. Because if I'm you're working for what do you call PCB PCP rotor router or whatever it is, that's my job. I'm willing to do it. You know, I don't think we have to define everything. I think we're on the road to making perfect the enemy of done.
I think
leave Paul to play with what we've suggested this evening and perhaps move on.
No, I think having the word diverse in there, to me, when you took diverse and quality jobs, that's the whole spectrum for me. That's what that means.
Yeah, as it says already. A good point.
Mm-hmm. And quality can also mean reliable. Like if you accept a job, you know it's going to be there for you. That this is a trustworthy place to live and to work.
Oh, no. Trustworthy place to live and to work. And that if you take a job, it will continue to be there for you. That this is a place of quality and trust.
Okay, great discussion. So we have a update on the
schedule. Anything else? I know that we jumped straight to this. Was there anything else that you wanted to debrief from the last meeting that isn't about this? Because this was the other half of that agenda item.
Anything else from the council meeting? I mean, this was the bulk of it, I think. But anything else, Paul? I see you're unmuted.
Oh, just by mistake, I guess.
Oh, no, you're allowed to be unmuted. I just wanted to make sure I wasn't missing you.
I think the one thing I had that is going to be a good head scratcher is how to better integrate both the subject of and the people involved with education into this work. A couple of the counselors talked about the importance of in South Burlington of how much that is. And this sort of speaks to your question of this is not the area of expertise of us to talk about education, but it is a component of the plan for our city about the value and importance of both the people, the kids and the teachers and the administrators and the subject of. So that was my one other big takeaway that is going to be a good challenge over the next year.
Okay. Perfect. Then I guess we can move on to the update on our work.
Yeah. There was no action item here. I just wanted to be reporting out. We'll be doing this quarterly and giving this to council. I realized that I left one item with a question mark next to it because I was filling it out and I forgot to fill in the number. But I just was giving you this update. If you've got any feedback about how you feel that we're at 25% of the way through the year, let us know. We know that we've been a little under capacity this summer, so probably didn't get to quite as much as we'd hoped, but that will hopefully very soon be rectified.
When is Kelsey coming back?
Very, very, very soon is our hope.
Not soon enough.
One quick question, Paul, is that we've had several people come before us
wanting some changes. Is that under address specific public comments on LDRs, or is it cleanup of 2022 LDR amendments? Where would that, you know, these?
Do you mean ones that came in a year ago that were part of the comment, or just as they come, folks like the Wrights who came?
Right. I was thinking, yeah, on the someone on Dorset Street, I forgot the name. Gentleman on Dorset Street had some issues.
That's a great question, Ted. We used to have it in our old work plans. I'm not sure if it came in here of address things that make space for things that come up.
Like a bike rack.
A bike rack, or you know, this recent one that you're doing the zoning change on next week. It's not specifically called out. It's sort of being opportunity oriented, I guess is how I would describe it, but I don't think it shows up totally in here. I would be happy to add a bit of a catch-all of, you know, be nimble enough to address subjects that present themselves during the year. Yes.
Sorry.
Yeah, well, okay. Let's stick to this.
Yes. Okay.
Okay.
Yep.
I guess one thing that just in the future, it's a little confusing. It says September 2023 report at the top of the column.
Yes.
I think know it's September of fiscal year.
Yeah, that's a...
Just feels funny.
Yeah. I was writing too many reports in too many fiscal years when I typed that. I should say September 22 of fiscal year.
Quick question. I see on a couple of these, it says we're going to... submit formal requests to another committee. When do those happen?
I am working diligently to get them to you in your next couple meetings.
Okay, so is it something we have to do on ours, or is it something you're just going to say, okay, I've submitted that request?
There's a couple that you've given us broad guidance on, but our hope is to give you sort of some one-pagers, especially related to the comp plan, to say, here's some guidance, here's what we'd like you to do, and have you all give a general thumbs up to that.
Okay, and then we would request it. Okay, yep. All right.
Okay, anything else? Okay, minutes from September 13. Michael, and then Ted.
Move to approve the minutes of September the 13th, 2022.
Second.
Okay, comment, Ted.
184. This has really noted the need for parks. Parks and dog parks. You said Butler Farms would like a dog park. If I said that, I didn't mean it. I meant to say we'll benefit from a dog park. I never asked anyone about the park. Allow me to change those words.
Okay, any other suggested edits?
Got that one, Sue?
No, I couldn't. I don't think his mic is on.
So Ted said that on page 4 of the minutes from September 13th, he is quoted as saying he said Butler Farms would like a dog park. He said he'd like to change that to he said Butler Farms would benefit from a dog park, because he didn't actually speak with people in Butler Farms.
Okay, you accept the change?
And Paul, I saw that you did go back and look at the video and you updated the motion.
Say again.
I'm just asking Paul a quick question first. You know,
is that from
about?
This set of minutes or a mm-hmm. prior? Yeah. Yes. So I think, is that correct now? Okay.
Yeah. I mean, it's written a little, but yes, that's correct.
Okay. Great.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. I think that was unanimous.
Yep.
Okay. Unanimous. Great. Okay. Under other business, there's a few things here. I got an email from someone on the Affordable Housing Committee saying that they've established a work group to look at making an inventory of areas in the city that are ripe for redevelopment, specifically in the Transit Overlay District. And they were wondering if someone from the Planning Commission would be willing to volunteer to work with their subcommittee, you know, because this is such a topic that you know, really relates to our work.
Do we have an idea how much time would be involved?
They did not say, no.
I see, Chris Trombley, that you are there, or at least you're on the...
And Darylyn.
Oh, and Darylyn, excuse me. perhaps one of you has some insight on that.
Hey, Paul. It's not a subcommittee, it's a work group. This work group kind of meets when they can. The purpose of having almost more like an advisor is we don't want to spend a lot of time going down a path that doesn't have the support of the planning commission. We want to come up with some solutions that are going to be low barrier, easy to get through, and are consistent with kind of the vision the planning commission has at this time. And if somebody, has an opportunity where they can sit down and review that document and maybe share some of that feedback or give some guidance, we'll take what we can get. We just don't want to waste time and put something forward that's not going to be adopted. So we want to be productive with our work.
When I read this, I don't know, Paul Engels, if you're willing or able, but this reminded me, and being familiar with some of what somewhat what they've been looking at, it would have impact on local neighborhoods, and similar to, you know, the work that we did with the task force and your concern about neighborhoods, I thought that you would be a great candidate if you're willing, but I don't know if anyone else has an interest in, oops, sorry, just putting that out there.
Go ahead.
I'm just not in a position to be able to take on anything more right now.
Okay. Chris, maybe I could have a conversation with you about this. We could, so that I can understand a bit more than we can elucidate this evening.
Yeah, that's awesome, Michael. You know, it's things that are kind of top of mind of, you know, how would these proposals be received by the neighborhoods? We really like the way the airport process worked, and kind of, you know, we don't want to have a blunt force object put upon a community that they're not supportive of. But to the conversation of, you know, climate refugees coming in and where we're going to put folks, just what conversation are we going to have? And we want to get to the low barrier stuff first.
That's part of my interest in it, is climate refugees. Okay. So I'll give you a call.
Does that seem like a reasonable approach from the rest of the group?
Mm-hmm.
Michael could. Okay. Great. Well, thank you, Michael. And thank you, Chris and Darylin, for working on this. I think it's not
a done deal yet.
Okay. Well, the conversation at least. Yes.
Michael, you're in, buddy.
And you're Michael. Okay. So I also heard from someone on the energy committee who's working with the other paper to have a column with a clean and green kind of focus, and they're interested to know if the planning commission would like to participate. They're also reaching out to a couple of the other committees to see. I just thought before, you know, I responded, I would bring it up with the group. I think the idea would be that, you know, one of us would, it wouldn't fall to staff. It would be like one of us would contribute something, but I guess one of my first thoughts was that clean and green is just one of the current comp plan's four kind of big topics. And it felt like, maybe if we're going to do the clean and green, maybe we would want to do three other articles at some time over the year, kind of focused on the other topics as well, just because, you know, from our work covers a kind of a broader spectrum than just one of the four categories. So that was just an initial thought. So, and I haven't replied yet. So I thought I'd see kind of what other commissioners thought as well.
Submit in on their own.
Ted, we can't hear you.
Oh, sorry.
Would members submit, or would we as a group submit? What is the,
I don't know. It sounded like they were going to have a regular column. So maybe more than once throughout the year one of us would volunteer to write an article on behalf of the Planning Commission, maybe focused on some of our work within that topic.
Like a guest
call. No, that sounds great. Maybe your question is more about process, right? Mm-hmm. Would we syndicate it so it would have, you know, everyone agree to exactly what it says, or would it just come from an individual?
I don't know.
Yeah, because if it's like on behalf of the Planning Commission,
it
kind of needs to be syndicated, right?
Yeah, because normally if we would write something, it would be from an individual who happens to be on the Planning Commission.
And you'd say this doesn't express the views of the planning, right?
Yeah. Right. I have done some when we're looking for feedback or like describing maybe parts of proposed LDR changes or something, which has been kind of from the chair of the Planning Commission, because it's very related to our work and things we've talked about. But you're right, this is kind of a different thing. Yeah.
I think this makes a lot of sense to communicate. I guess I would maybe just want to get an understanding with the Energy Committee that even though, say, some of us would participate, it would be an individual capacity. Like, I happen to be on the Planning Commission, I'm aware of this, I'm writing this. Not everyone may agree, there's not official city policy, like, and it would just, instead of having a whole process around it.
Yeah, I don't know, Paul, you look like you're deep in thought there.
Two quick thoughts on it. One, I was invited also to, separately from the commission, and I've agreed to write one that talks about the recently adopted climate action plan as being one of the first ones, because that is policy of the city. You could, if you wanted to, do it as the Planning Commission. I think to a certain extent, the Energy Committee is pretty open to how you all might want to structure it. So you could do one that is, you know, it takes the clean and green column and says, here's where we're at and here's what we're thinking about for the next comprehensive plan on all fronts, for example. Or you could
with energy related things that we did.
You could say, here's what we're doing to implement the climate action plan this year. I think that they are hoping that it represents the city to a certain, the city or a committee to a certain extent, rather than an individual. But I don't know that as for certain. And you also don't have to say yes or yes right away. You can think about what you want to do.
So the answer to them is we're thinking about it?
That's a reasonable answer if we want to think about it. I'll ask more about how they think about the process and how often it might be. So I'll do that. I'll get some more information. Then upcoming meetings, we have these ones listed. They look like all our regular ones, right?
Yep. I was mostly just, I know that a couple of commissioners have asked about where certain pieces are at. So I just wanted to note that we're getting ramped up to have a robust discussion on energy and solar pieces. There's several different moving parts of that we're excited to share with you. The work request that you mentioned, Duncan, a few minutes ago. Next month, you'll be starting to look at the annual Unified Planning Work Program requests, which include the transportation studies. So we're going to try to bring that to you early so that you can be thinking about what does studying transportation mean in next year? And obviously the comp plan and getting going heavily with that. So just preview of coming attractions.
I will not be here the 25th. So.
Okay,
have fun.
What? You're malingering?
He said he was going to Egypt, didn't he? Or am I making that up?
Nice.
Okay. Anything else? That was everything on the official agenda. I want to thank everyone. I actually thought we had a long agenda for this evening, but we have ended early, which pretty much never happens when I chair. So thank you all. Have a wonderful evening.
Thank you, Jess. I think it is on record.
You know, it's my sore arm rushing me forward. Do you want to keep the cast and then six and splint them? Oh. So I should be out of the splint by.